This is America's Roundtable from Washington, D.C. On behalf of our engaged listening audience via the Pledge Radio in Michigan, Lancer Broadcasting in the Midwest, we're delighted to welcome Aaron Perini to America's Roundtable. Aaron Perini is the Director of Press Communications for the Trump 2020 campaign. Welcome, Aaron.
Welcome, Aaron.
Thank you so much for having me.
According to the advanced estimate released by the U.S. Bureau of Economic Analysis this week, real gross domestic product, GDP, decreased at an annual rate of 32.9% in the second quarter of 2020. The nationwide unemployment rate jumped from 11.2% to 11.6% for the week ending July 18. This decline is the result of shutting down of the U.S. economy due to the China's coronavirus. With stay-at-home orders issued in March and April, the growing U.S. economy was shut down due to the coronavirus pandemic. Now, lockdown is not the cure. It may slow down the infection rate, but will also result in prolonged downturn and slow recovery. There is a huge difference when comparing the current downturn to the recession of 2008 and 2009, for example. The recession in 2008 was caused by economic factors, and it led to permanent shutting of segments of the economy. We should remember that the current economic downturn is caused by the coronavirus pandemic and not by economic factors. And by reopening the economy, we should go back to resuming the immediate economic growth. This time, when economy opens, people will have jobs again and unemployment will fall. Aaron, what is President Trump's plan to get the U.S. economy back to pre-coronavirus levels at a faster pace?
Well, I think that there are a couple of things that we know about what it's going to take to get America back to where it was before the coronavirus, economically speaking. One, it's going to mean that we have to begin to safely reopen because people need to be able to get paychecks and get back to work. And so there are a few factors that go into that. One of those including being able to get kids back safely into schools. Why? There are so many reasons for children themselves to be back in school, including physical, social, mental reasons, but there are economic reasons as well, because their parents should also be able to get back to work so that the economy can begin to safely reopen. We saw as the economy began to reopen, jobs came soaring back. And we saw that with record-breaking job numbers both in May and June. The annualized number is if, that annualized GDP number would be if we stayed in the current economic pace for the entire year. So it's not a true accurate reflection of where we stand. Did the economy retract? Yeah, but that's because we had to shut it down to save upwards of 4 million American lives. There was a lot at stake by not stepping back, having to shut things down. We needed to be able to slow the spread as we began to do things like set therapeutics up to begin the fastest work possible on a vaccine. And just as the economy is beginning to take off again, where we are seeing these record-breaking jobs numbers both in May and June, Joe Biden wants to stifle that economic recovery with over $7 trillion in tax hikes. You want to talk about eliminating small businesses, eliminating opportunity. You elect Joe Biden president and you'll see exactly what it looks like. He himself has said day one, he will undo the Trump tax cuts. So what does that mean? That means taxes get raised on 80% of Americans almost immediately, and it's going to put the corporate business tax rate in this country higher than communist China. That is not going to help this economy get roaring back when Joe Biden would actually work to stifle opportunity in this country. The only person who can get back to the booming Trump economy we saw before with record low unemployment, business opportunity, investment, a raging stock market, the opportunity for people to save more, and you saw spending in the economy going up is President Trump. We've seen what an economic recovery looks like under Joe Biden. What does that look like? Stagnant wages, the slowest economic recovery since World War II. The facts are all out there. The only person that can get our economy back is President Trump.
A coronavirus pandemic is not just limited to United States. European Commission predicted a recession of historic proportions for the European Union and its 27 member countries, predicting a largest contraction since World War II. So it's not just limited to the U.S., the current crisis that we're in, but obviously with a proven record by President Trump, we can expect much faster recovery than, as you mentioned, from Biden.
Democratic presidential candidate Joe Biden unveiled a $2 trillion plan to combat climate change. And according to the Wall Street Journal, the Democratic presidential candidate would use climate policy as an economic development tool for over 4 years. Now, the Wall Street Journal reports, I quote, former Vice President Joe Biden unveiled a $2 trillion proposal to combat climate change, calling for a bigger investment and faster action than he backed during the Democratic primaries earlier this year, unquote. And we also have to take into consideration that, you know, there are other writers that have communicated, including Robert Bryce in Forbes, who says it would require installing 9 times as much wind capacity as now exists in the country, or roughly twice as much as current global capacity. Germany has a great magazine called Der Spiegel, and they wrote an excellent piece last year, and basically it was a damning report about Germany's efforts to really support the renewables policy that they had. And they were going to be spending some 3.4 trillion euros. And they're showing great failure because it's not able to meet their needs and it's causing economic problems. Now, when you compare what President Trump and also Democratic presidential candidate Biden is proposing, what are the key differences that we note? And Aaron, if you can enlighten us as to what we should expect if we have Biden in the White House in the next 4 years.
What could be expected if Joe Biden were to win is the loss of energy independence in this nation and the killing of upwards of 10 million energy-related jobs in the United States. Let's look at the fact. President Trump's agenda for energy is pro-jobs, pro-national security, and produces energy independence in this nation. We've seen it work out. When we become a sole energy producer ourselves, when we allow the United States to become a net exporter of energy like we saw under President Trump with his deregulatory agenda, with the streamlining of the permitting process, and the ability for private investment into infrastructure, what did we see? We saw more national sovereignty. We saw the ability for the United States to not be beholden to foreign nations for our energy, to get to work, to run our businesses, to heat and cool our homes. President Trump made sure that American sovereignty remained the focus and secured jobs. We have the cleanest air and the cleanest water we've ever had in the United States, and President Trump has been able to produce energy independence. The two do not need to be mutually exclusive. You can do both at the same time without killing jobs the way Joe Biden would. Joe Biden supports the Green New Deal, which would cost upwards of $93 trillion. That's not something that this economy can withstand. And it would put a $600,000 tax burden on every household in the country. And that is for this sole policy proposal. And it's not about clean energy for them. It's not about energy independence. It's about none of that. It is about reshaping the American economy to a more socialist form so that they can have more control over what people do day to day. And that is unbelievable. That would not allow the United States to be a free and fair country. It would limit opportunity substantially. President Trump has fought hard and has done things like increased exports of natural gas by nearly fivefold. When you get government out of the way and you allow business to go forward, you see what happens. Energy independence is good for America. Clean energy is good for America. And President Trump has shown you can do both. Joe Biden wants to eliminate that ability for the United States to be energy independent. Why? Because he had to sell out to the far radical left, including Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez and Bernie Sanders. He has a Bernie Biden unity plan, which includes energy policy, in order to try and finally secure the Democrat nomination in this country. And what would happen to the United States? Absolute energy elimination. You would see a country that is not recognizable. And that means the cost to heat homes in states like any state in the United States, Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, Michigan, would all increase. And that is not what Americans need. Really, this is just another cog in the wheel of the inability of Joe Biden to successfully lead the nation back from the coronavirus. When you're raising taxes, when you're raising the cost of goods, when you're raising the ability for somebody to even be able to afford to heat and cool their home, that is not what this country needs as we are trying to come back. Joe Biden would strangle the American economy to be satisfactory for the American left, the socialist wing of this country. President Trump wants energy independence. He wants people to be able to afford to save money and heat and cool their homes. They shouldn't be mutually exclusive, but under Joe Biden, they are.
Right, Gary, you mentioned a few times socialism. Even today, corrupt governments in Eastern Europe and then China, Russia, and Iran are still censoring news detrimental to their power. As American citizens, we are now experiencing censorship by privately owned companies, which dominate and have monopolies in the social media arena and the search engine sphere. The same American companies which are working with corrupt governments in power around the world are working against elected officials of a democratically elected government in the U.S. through censorship. What is President Trump's plan to address this important issue of ensuring freedom of speech and media freedom?
Well, you've seen President Trump take action, especially regarding Section 230 of the FCC compliance rules. Currently in the United States, there's the ability for businesses to be able to hide under Section 230 as their reason that they get to censor what the president is saying, what other people are saying in the United States. But social media should not be the arbiters of truth. Sundar Pichai and Mark Zuckerberg and Jeff Bezos should not be able to dictate what is or is not a fact in the United States. They are actively doing that to suppress the voice of the American people. And President Trump is unafraid to say, that's not okay. You are abusing Section 230 to try and decide what the American people should see. The president firmly believes in the liberties enshrined in the Constitution of the United States, the Bill of Rights. Those are important things to him, and he has fought every day. Whether it's the First Amendment or the Second Amendment, he has fought to protect freedoms in this country, and it is something you will see him do day in and day out. We're hopeful that Congress might be able to act as well. There's some good things going on there, especially, you know, with House Republican leader Kevin McCarthy. I used to work for Kevin before I came on the campaign. He's always been very big into stop the bias, stopping these social media giants from, you know, doing things on Twitter like shadow banning conservative voices where you can't find people. Instagram does the same thing where you shadow ban. You block these videos. You block these conversations. President Trump's going to make sure that we don't eliminate the ability in this conversation to have a free and fair conversation just because the liberal elites, the Palo Alto Mafia, don't like what the right and what the silent majority have to say in this country.
Erin Perini, we thank you so much for joining us on America's Roundtable and truly appreciate what you're doing for our country. And as you've served in Congress with Kevin McCarthy and the rest of the team members there on the conservative side, your leadership is truly much appreciated. Thank you indeed, Erin.
Thank you, Erin.
Thank you both.
Thank you for joining us on America's Roundtable. America's Roundtable from Washington, D.C. is an initiative of the U.S.-based think tank International Leaders Summit. I'm Joe Lana Sami, your co-host, joined by Natasha Sardosh, economist and co-founder of the International Leaders Summit. Subscribe to America's Roundtable on Apple Podcasts and via YouTube on International Leaders Summit.